And you can put it into your development cycle. So for example, when deploying your application into production, that you first build a gate into it and have Linux run on your systems as well. And if that gives a positive report, that you then deploy the application. Like you can make your own test to test for the HTTP headers, for example. So if you think, well, that's a good idea, then build your own test and say, okay, I want in my configuration file with this name, I want to test if those kind of strings are there. And if they aren't, then I fire up a warning and then I tell my deployment tooling that something is wrong, that I first have to fix that and then deploy. As said, simplification and simplicity is maybe nowadays the most important thing you can do. Too many things are way too complicated. And I think as developers, we are guilty in that we are technical, so we make assumptions about who is reading the code or how our users should be doing things. Well, the easier you make it, the better it is. And a simple example, if you just run Linux, it will give you help. And so many Linux tools, if you just run it, it actually starts running some daemon or something else, and you don't even know what it does. Actually, I often install software to test it out, and the first thing I do is not read the documentation, of course. I first start running some utility, and then find out, oh, it's already running, and it's doing things maybe I don't even want to do. So what Linux does is it gives you first some help and say, hey, this is what you can do if you want to start the audit. And that's also maybe a possibility in your applications that if you simply run the application, does it give any output to the user? Or does it simply do something? Or does it stop without saying anything? So simplification is a very important area. And as I said, within my company, we try to focus on that a lot to make sure that every step is as simple as possible. It saves a lot of support issues, and also with the frustration factor for your users will go down a lot, so that they, when they need to find out something, that they really are going to look in the documentation instead of thinking, oh, if the following thing or it's the next thing in line, which doesn't make any sense. The tool can be downloaded, so as said, I will share the presentation. If you are running Linux, just have a look at the tool later. Someone doing already some code auditing? So using some tools? Well, Robert collected a nice input from a few of you. Sharing what kind of code auditing utilities were in use. What I've seen is that still a lot of people don't use it, and it makes sense because sometimes there are not that many tools. So I've provided here a few quick wins, depending of course on the language you're using. If you never used a tool like that, I would suggest that and make that at least one of the three learning points of this evening. Even if you think you can write the best code ever, I'm sure that a tool like this, and for example the linting tools, which you just check for, well, grammar, will already find things which you maybe never discovered yourself. So that's a quick win. And of course you can use other people which are smart and do security testing. Anyone using pen testing companies? Like the Fox ITs and the Pines and a few, okay. You can do also code reviews. Most often those companies provide that as well. And if you never done that, I think it's also an interesting one. The only exception is usually a tool is, well, free or cheap. A code review you have to give the code to a Fox IT or a Pine or Madison Gurkha, and they are very expensive because they have to, well, get someone doing that all the time. So if you want to earn more money, someone want to earn more money? Mm-hmm. No one? Yeah? Oh, one. That's honest. This is a very interesting area. If you are a very good programmer and you like security, then you might consider becoming the code reviewer for your team. Even if you bring it in as a voluntary service for your colleagues and say, hey, I want to learn code auditing and reviewing because later on I want to be very rich. Do that. Repositories, the gentleman there already said something about Git. It's an interesting one because like protecting your crown jewels, passwords, unique IDs, secrets, they are often stored in our code, and if you don't take precautions, then they come up at GitHub, for example. You can see here a few examples where it says device secret key with a key. Well, and most likely you don't want that on GitHub, so unless of course it's a temporary key, but there are some serious issues already. And I've added some links for later reading, which shows some examples as well. If you want to check that yourself, again, become the auditor, the technical auditor, then use these kind of instructions and say, well, show me all the conf or the configuration files with the string password in it. So even if you tomorrow start with doing these on your GitHub accounts, you might find surprises already. And well, if you find something, I would really advise you to rotate passwords, of course, and not say, oh, let's fix GitHub and then it's fixed, but really change your passwords as well. So again, regarding hardening, you should do hardening on your operating system, your own systems, your code, like with secure programming, input validation, and having others actually reviewing your code, and like the GitHub data, your secrets. Then a few giveaways I found recently, and things go very quick, so I've collected them. The data protection laws, as said, in the Netherlands, it's now active. So if you're leaking personal data, you can get a serious fine. And I'm still waiting for the first company to go out of business for that. And it happened a few times already that companies lost, for example, the access to their Amazon infrastructure, and that everything got wiped. So all their virtual machines, all the backups, and all the assets and the data, well, you're just finished then with your company. And especially if you cannot access your backups anymore. So this is an interesting one. If you want to buy more time with your manager, because your project should be finished, then you can say, no, wait, we have to apply a few more things, because if we don't do that, we might be getting in the news soon, and that will cost us a lot more. So might be a smart trick to apply. OWASP, as said, it's a big project with a lot of small projects. So if you're doing something new or getting a new project, definitely check out OWASP again, because it might be possible that they have a new project which really applies to your situation. And it can be like with WordPress, a new guide, or it can be that security framework tool, which is very handy as well. Rails, they implemented the HTTP security headers since the last few versions. So if you're using that, make sure that you are running on the the latest version. So that's a very interesting one, and especially again with the securityheaders.io website, you can check if your application is already supporting it. Well, the Internet of Things, especially developers, they should be the first ones to jump onto that bandwagon and learn about it, because we already have scales which tell you your weight and then send it to the cloud. But there will be a lot of small utilities and other interesting things which will benefit from it. And if you can leverage that kind of technology, it's also with the waste disposal, it's also a newer thing. And nowadays you have applications for everything, so I think it will be more interesting and maybe even also a money maker. And then there's another thing: if you like development and you like also the operations, then there's now the DevOps movement, and it's always a little bit vague on what that specifically is. Is that if you're a developer and then also do some system administration, because well, the system administration got sacked and well, you had to do it. Does that then promote you to DevOps? Or is it the other way around, that you do system administration and then learn a little bit of code? I don't know, but what I do know is that more and more people will be expected to not just building applications, but also understanding the whole stack on where you deploy it. And it might be Amazon, but it might be also still normal hardware in the data center. The next level would be security on top of it. And actually, there are a lot of new terms for it. So I've seen Sec DevOps and DevOps Sec, and also DevSec Ops. So I'm not sure what it will be called, but one thing is for sure, that security is in demand, and the best paying people, I think, will be in security as well. Unless you're a manager, of course, then you have different responsibilities, and then I think you should also earn more. But security is definitely an interesting field, and it will be applying soon with the DevOps movement.